Yes. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me here tonight. Anything that I say or do is my way. It is not the only way. If there was one way of doing this, we'd all be doing it the same way, okay? So my ways, it suits me. The majority of yous, I would have thought, took up woodturning for one reason, and that's to enjoy it. And that's what it's all about, enjoying it. Whether you scrape the wood or cut the wood, I would advise you to take woodturning to a level of skill that suits you as an individual, okay? Tools, for example, there's tools out there, the easy roughing tools. They do exactly what they say they do. They'll easy rough something out, okay? And it will remove wood. You may have to use a coarser grit to sand, okay? Because they tear the wood. They don't cut, they tear. But that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. If Arnie turned a bowl with a gouge and cut it, and I scraped the bowl, and we both sanded them properly, you wouldn't be able to tell which one was cut and which one was scraped. So, you know, scraping isn't wrong. It's not necessarily the most efficient way of removing timber, but it's not wrong. The main thing about this is to do whatever you're doing and do it safely, okay? You cannot get better at woodturning without making mistakes. It's impossible. I'm self-taught. I've made every mistake you could possibly make. I never have the benefit of something like this. So it was a longer road for me, but I'm glad I'm self-taught, because when I'm teaching, I know what can happen before it even happens. So I can pre-warn the guys who I'm teaching. That makes a big difference. Right, tools. Long grind bowl gouge. Long grind, Irish grind, Celtic grind, swept back wing grind, Ellsworth grind, okay? It's basically the wings are swept back. I put a soft curve on there, and that angle is approximately 60 degrees. I don't know, and I'm not interested, okay? A lot of guys will say, oh, your bevel must be X. If so, if it must be X, does that mean, we'll say, for example, 40%? So does that mean if it's 41% or 39%, it's wrong? Bullshit, okay? Bullshit. All you're doing is it's more important that the tool is sharp. Secondly, I make no apologies for using this system here, the one-way grinding system. Apparently, some of the more mature woodturners advocate you can't really be a proper all-round woodturner unless you can sharpen by hand. Bullshit again. That's rubbish, okay? All you're doing when you're putting an edge on your tool is putting a good edge on to work the wood efficiently. How you get there, it doesn't make any difference. There is no kudos now in being able to sharpen by hand. Not when we have equipment which does it quicker and easier. What you have to remember is, up to a point, the older guys, and years ago in England, the spindle turners, which it was mostly spindle turning, they weren't turning bowls. And they certainly didn't have the long grind, which originated from a guy called Liam O'Neill in Ireland. He's the one who started the long grind off. Ellsworth saw it in Ireland, brought across here, and popularized it under his name. Fair enough. But yeah, that tool there. The one-way grinding system is quick, easy, accurate, and it gives you repeatability. And if you can repeat that grind every time, it kicks in muscle memory. And if your muscles are remembering the same grinds, you're standardizing everything. My jig, a lot of people don't know this on this jig. I've set this to where mine is at home, okay? That grub screw is in line with the second notch. If you bring that leg further up there, what it does is it takes this wing further over. So that angle isn't as sharp as that angle. That's why I've got mine further down here. Now, my wings are quite upright. I'm prepared to sacrifice edge-holding ability to give me a cleaner, more efficient cut. I go through that size tool and that size tool every 5 to 6 months, okay? They're gone. Because I do a lot of sharpening. I know how important it is. And that there, if I was stuck on a desert island with a lathe, which I promise you would not be my first choice, okay? And I could pick one tool, that would be the tool I would pick. I can use that in so many different ways, a very, very versatile tool. So, when it comes to sharpening, use whatever method on, and that's what I was gonna say. If the old timers happened to have this time of grind, you mark my words, they would have not tried to do that freehand. They would have designed some kind of jig to do this grind. Metal handles. I don't think I have any. I don't have a metal handle. They're cold in the winter. There's no ergonomic shape to them. Okay, you can't put a swelling in like that and a slim handle and a fatter at the end. Wood is warm, it's comfortable, it's earthy, and it's, you know, it's nice to work. And again, if it was a big deal to have metal handles, the old timers would have put metal handles on. Okay, so I'm in that real advocate. That there is the business end. That is just a way of holding the business end. And they're coming out with tools now. This marketplace is designed like any other to get you to spend your money. Okay, if you're a fly fisherman, Sage, Winston, Loomis will bring out a new fly rod every year, and it'll be doubly bound with boron or whatever. That rod is designed to catch the fisherman, not the fish. And it works every time, every time. You know, golf, if you're a golfer, Callaway, the other makers, Ping, Callaway. They'll bring out a new club which has a sweeter spot, or Titleist will bring a new ball. If you can hit it that far, it'll drive it another 10 yards. We're splitting hairs here now. So, the first cut I'm going to do is to true this up here. I'm going to do a push cut. That bevel on your ball gouge does two things. It tells you in which direction you're cutting and controls the tool. If you make a cut with the gouge, you should be aiming for a perfectly flat, smooth surface. If you get that, that bevel is in exactly the right position. If you can imagine that bevel floating behind the cut, being like the sole of a plane, okay? And that bevel helps you to stop tipping the tool up, stop it rocking. It helps to guide the tool. It stops it from rocking on the surface of the wood, and it gives you the control. I'm going to do a push cut through here. I'm going to close the flute. As soon as I pick the cut up, open the flute to 45, and then I just lean through. What I use my body a lot, so I'm holding the tool there, and it's into my body. And all I have to do is just lean forwards. You've got far more control doing a cut like that than you have trying to do it like this with these two elbows free. You tend to do that with the tool. And whatever happens at that end, so if you're cutting and you're just holding it like that, if that end's wobbling like this, the tip of the tool's wobbling, and it'll reflect on the surface of the wood, okay? If there's anything that I say that doesn't make sense, please ask the question. This is a great opportunity, and there's no such thing as a daft question if you don't know the answer. That's it, and don't be shy about other people in the room saying, oh, what a nugget, you should know that. It's not the case, right? If you don't know, ask. Very important.
What a what?
A nugget. Okay. A nugget, it's something thick and chunky.
Oh, okay.
Oh God, that's an English expression. Right, so speed. I'm going to try and turn this as fast as I can safely. What I consider safe and you consider safe may be different, okay? But I find the faster that's turning, there's less resistance to the cut. It's like if you went into a field of long grass with a sickle or a scythe and it was razor sharp and you just went like that. The stalks, you might cut through one or two, and one and two might just not cut. But if you went like this, you'd cut through the grass with very little resistance. It's the same with a piece of wood. The faster it's turning, generally, there's a lot less resistance to the cut. If you're going to look anywhere, you should be looking there. Look at the profile. That tells you what you're cutting when you're cutting it. If you just look at the tool, that's all you're seeing. All you're watching is the tool cutting. You're not looking at the profile. Take that to there, it needs a little bit more. Just lean through, so that's nice and round. Move the tool rest around to here. Put that there. I've already marked, I'm gonna hold this in the recess, so I've already marked, but I'll tell you what, I know these are more accurate. Yeah. I scribe with the left leg, match up with the right leg. Two things, do not hold them in that position, okay? And do not let that right leg touch. It's on the other side of center. If that right leg touches, these will quickly flick out of your hand and stick in your neck. So just be careful.
How do you know that?
Oh, you again? Right. I've got your number straight away, mate. Parting tool. That's tediously slow. Actually, it's true now. It's true on this face. It was on 1200. Now we can get it up to a nice 2000.
You're a
Okay, so I make three cuts there. The depth of that cut is about an eighth of an inch. That's all we need. Parting tool, ball gouge. And I cut the rest of that away. I get a nice flat. I could, if I wanted to, just keep on going down with the parting tool. Just keep on going down like that. Just draw this across. One thing I will say though, it has to be absolutely true where the chuck is going to sit.
Are you doing a flat side or a bevel?
Am I doing what?
A dovetail?
No, this chuck is not dovetailed.
Okay.
So I'm not putting a dovetail on because it's the one-way chuck, which is square. I prefer the dovetail chuck. Right, that cut there is half the depth of that one. If I made that cut and that cut the same depth, when you hold like that, you've got a weak ring. You can break the ring out. If I make that cut half the depth of that, the jaws are still holding into solid wood. I've got a much, much better grip. That's the foot, draw cut. I remove the wood from there so that I know exactly what I've got left to work with. The foot isn't part of the curve. It's just where it sits. So, take that to there. That's how much wood I want for this platter. It's actually a little bit too deep. Now then, you might think to yourself, bloody hell, I've paid X amount, $40 for that. There's no way I'm gonna waste any of this wood, okay? That's not necessarily the best thing. What is it that sells a piece of wood turning? What do you think, what's the first thing that people look at?
The grain, the color.
We'll say the aesthetics. The shape and the form and the aesthetics, okay? How it looks, the shape and form. That's what's gonna attract you to a piece of wood, what the shape looks like. Now then, I know for a platter that would be too deep. And you might be thinking to yourself, bugger, I'm gonna be turning about maybe $15 worth of wood away. That doesn't matter. However much you paid for that, you're gonna add the price onto the piece at the end. Your customers don't know if it was that big or that big to start. They have no idea. So add the price of the wood on, and you'd be better off losing a little bit and getting a more pleasing shape, which would sell better than using the whole piece and you get a clunky, thick, horrible shape and you'll never sell it. So you're better off wasting some wood if you need to make a shape that is much more aesthetically pleasing. You're not gonna lose money if you're selling it, okay? Because you're gonna add the price of the platter on anyway. So, OG, I'm gonna cut an OG in this. So, there's a very easy way of producing an OG and I'm gonna divide this into thirds. And I want that third there, so I've got two thirds and one third. I've got the thickness that I want, and I'm gonna put a line there. That's where I'm gonna aim for. The thickness up here is gonna eventually be an eighth of an inch thick. That's what I'm aiming for, and the reason I aim for that, or leave a little bit more, is if you don't hit the curve and you need to adjust it, you've got a little bit more room to work with, okay? You can take what off, but you can't put it back on. All that there, I will take away, okay? Because the platter is gonna be better that thickness. So, the OG, I'm gonna set the tool rest perpendicular to these two points here, and I'm gonna cut a cove from there to there. Then all I've gotta do is put the halfway line on, because an OG is 50-50, okay? And that curve is the opposite of that curve. It's like a sign. So, this is the easiest way I've found to do it. The draw cut is the most efficient way of removing timber. Drawing the tool towards you. The push cut is a good finishing cut, but to remove timber quickly, that's the best grind, okay? Using the wing of the tool. Move the tool rest a little closer. Right, I'm taking that up to 23 now. That's better. Right, I need a bit more of a curve in there. This cut. Can anybody tell me what's wrong with the cut I'm making? It's to do with grain direction. I'm cutting against the grain. The wood on the outside of a bowl is always running from there to there. That's the way you should do a finishing cut. You can see it's tearing out badly there, very badly there, and very badly there. I'm not bothered because that's the curve that I want. I'm going to refine that curve and I'm going to get a better shape and a better finish. So that, I'm not bothered about cutting against the grain there. I'm going to adjust it. So we want to go, the OG is 50-50, so I'm going to put a line on here. And again, I just eyeball it. I make aesthetic measurements. And all I've got to do now is soften this curve here into that curve there at around about that point. The easiest way by far. And where you're sitting, Arnie, you'll see the OG just appear as I soften this curve into that one. Okay? So. You see it starting to form. Now you just have to refine it. I never, ever, ever leave a flat there. If you leave a flat there, it looks like the piece is sitting down on itself. I want that curve to come straight out from the foot and present itself up. And that to there. Again, just doing draw cuts. And there you've got a nice soft OG. I can see a little high point there. I can feel it. There's a one there and the one there. I can see the two lines. And the reason I can see them, there, that one's gone, is because they'll cast a slight shadow. So, there we go. That was the draw cut. There's two cuts that figure's beautiful. Do you know what? I'll show you the other cut. Now this cut here is the push cut. I was using a draw, I'm gonna show you two finishing cuts. This cut here, I'm using a little 3/8 bowl gouge with a standard English grind at 45 degrees. I just drop it in the jig like that, bring the arm out, drop it in the jig, get that bevel parallel to the wheel, flush with the wheel, and then just roll it round. Simple English grind. I'm using a small tool. I could, if I wanted to, use that tool, pick the cut up and push it through. I'm doing a finishing cut here. The only thing that I want to make sure is that on the end grain, it's around about there, on the end grain there and there, there's no tear out. I'm only taking a cut on this, maybe a 1/16 of an inch deep at the very most. So using that tool with a bigger flute, a bigger radius, is like using a sledgehammer to crack a nut. You don't need that size of tool to do this finishing cut. This tool is lighter, easier to maneuver, it's got a smaller radius, so it's inherently going to want to take a smaller cut with a lot of control. You don't need that size tool for this cut. So, the hard part of this is not the cut itself, it's you maintaining the profile that you've already got on there. Because the tendency is for guys to pick the cut up, they'll go so far, then they'll slip out of the cut. Put the tool back on, pick the cut up, go so far, and then slip out of the cut again. Put the tool on, and they've just cut a couple of flats on there. What you're looking for when you make this cut is the thickness of the cut. And I look there, I don't look here. When I'm making the cut down here, I'm looking down the side of the cut and I can't see how wide it is. If I look there, I'm looking square on and I can see how thick it is. If I see the cut I'm making get wider, it means I'm going into the piece. If it gets smaller, it means I'm coming out. If I keep that cut the same thickness all the way around, I'm maintaining that profile. I'm taking the same amount off all the way around. Does that make sense? Good. Right, so. Bevel rubbing first, that's your control. Pull the handle towards you. Nice, small, careful cuts, okay? And I can see I've got a nice finish on there. Now there's some hesitations, these lines here. Some of that, there's a hesitation around about there, and that's because there's a nick in the tool rest. So that it dropped into that little nick and had to come up. That is a hesitation, and you get a line on there. The good thing is there's absolutely no tear out whatsoever. Okay, that's as clean as a whistle. The grain is lying that way, the bevel is lying the fibres down, and you're making a cut, it's supporting them right till you get to the very end. If you try to do a finishing cut from there to there, you're actually going against the grain, that bevel isn't supporting anything, and you're cutting against the grain straight away, and it just lifts it up. So you always make your finishing cuts from there to there, always. Now then, this tool, I can use this tool for a finishing cut if I change the angle I approach to the work. Now, I've been using the bottom wing. I've got a diamond hone here. I'm gonna put an edge on with a diamond hone. And I want you, will one of these cameras zoom in there? Mm-hmm. About there?
Yeah.
Excellent, because I want to show you the difference between a scrape and a sheer cut, okay? So, now, if any of yous use negative rake scrapers, if you think of this tool, the flute comes up like that in the middle, then you've got the bevel. If you turn that on its edge, that's just a really sharp negative rake scraper. That's all it is, okay? So I can use this tool in loads of different ways. Beginner wood turners, I was fortunate because I worked in the business, so it wasn't quite as expensive for me. But beginner wood turners, sometimes I feel sorry for. It's a minefield of information out there. Which chuck do I get? Which tools? There's loads of tools, loads of chucks. How much do I want to pay? I would generally say you only get what you pay for from a quality point of view. We were talking about a Barracuda chuck today. The Barracuda chuck, you can buy a chuck and several jaws, all kind of gold plated or whatever, for $200. A chuck key, all those jaws for $200. When you use them, the chuck key, eventually the teeth here in the chuck key, they wear away on the cogs. We would call it monkey metal or pot metal. It's no good. It's not very good. There was no bargains, or very few bargains. The only time you'll get a bargain, and it's an unfortunate situation, is when somebody passes. Seriously, and the wife's getting rid of the workshop. That's when you tend to get a bargain, okay? So, if I use this tool here, and I use it on its edge, if I talk about the flute being open, it's fully open at 12 o'clock. Closed that way, 3 o'clock. Closed that way, 9 o'clock. So if I put this tool on its edge, I'll do it on the long grain there, right on its edge, and do this. You can see that it's scraping the wood there, and those shavings are like rolling up a carpet, okay? Right, so that's with the flute closed, that's a scrape. If I drop the handle to here, I'm going to use the back of the wing there, which is almost flat. Move this tool rest out of the way. And again, I'm holding the tool there, and it's in the top of my leg this time. Okay, so when I make this cut, again, I'm moving my whole body. That tool is held in position. If I put the tool in this position, I'm gonna make a cut, and make a slice. I'm trying to get it to stay on there. Try it there, there we go. Look at that shaving. That is a tight coil. So that's telling you that it's cutting the wood. If you get a coil, it's cutting, okay? If it's a rolled up shaving, that's scraping. A coil shaving is cutting. So, and I should be able to get rid of these hesitation lines as well. So the angle is, I'm way above the center line. Drop it down a touch. All those lines have disappeared and get right into that corner. Blend that in. And that's a real sheer cut. They're the shavings I was just taking off. Really light, fine, gossamer shavings. And that would take very little sanding. There's one high point, and it's right there. Can you see the difference between the tone of wood? That's got a different shade to it. So that tells me that there's a slight high point right there. So you can just come back. Just blend that in. And there we've got a nice soft OG. Right, so sanding. We need to sand and seal this. 180, 243, 2400. And I like these discs here. I get them from a guy out of Texas, Steve Rooster from Texas. And every one has a number stamped on the back. It's Merkur Abrasive, and Merkur Abrasive comes out of Finland, and it's a very, very good abrasive, a good quality abrasive. So, sanding pad, we'll just quickly put it, finish on this. Not like that. Is this, why does it click?
You got to turn the camera.
Ah, right, yeah, yeah.
There you go,
that is
way on.
There. Your first sand is the most important one. You've got to get rid of any disturbed grain or tear out.
Are you in reverse?
Yeah, you know.
Forward. It's going that way. Yeah, that's right, isn't it?
Okay. I'm sorry because the wood spins so fast.
It's unscrewing it. Right, well, tell you what. There was a decent enough finish from the tool, so this won't take long. Right, so the sanding pad is much easier than the discs. Quicker and easier, sorry. So 320. The sand in there. In here, that's actually too fast for sanding. That's better. I've turned it down to about 800 to 1000. I can feel the paper biting in better. If you go too fast, the paper can skid over the surface and hasn't got time to bite in. There, into here, right into the corners. And finishing, I think, is a very, very important part of turning. You can have a turning which maybe doesn't quite look right, or might be out of proportion slightly, but if the finish is good, that makes a massive difference. I've seen turnings, excellent turnings, which weren't finished properly, and it makes a big difference. It seems a great shame to get the shape and form right, and then not spend the time to finish it, to sand and finish it properly. Those three elements go to make a good wood turning. The shape, the form, the aesthetics, I think, is the most important. Then after that, how well it's turned, and just as importantly, how well it's finished. Right, if I'm gonna color this, it's gonna be thinner at the end grain there. I'm gonna waste this much wood. This'll be a much nicer piece, shape-wise, and it'll sell much quicker as well. So I need to seal the wood. This is shellac, thinned down 50-50. I prefer to use thinned finishes. I like Zinsser's seal coat, okay? It's pure shellac, there's no fillers, there's no wax in it, and I thin that down 50-50. And the reason for that is some of the finishes you get from the tin or the cans are too thick and syrupy. Any woodworker will tell you, you're better off putting several thin coats on and building up to a finish than putting a thick syrupy one on and having to cut it back. Plus, the capillary action will draw it in, it's thinner, the capillary action will draw it in. You use a different pronunciation, don't you? Capillary, yeah. Capillary action.
Which we also know about aluminium and aluminum.
Yeah. Well, gentlemen, we gave you the language and you've completely screwed it up. but then again, if I be honest with you, I entirely blame the British for allowing you guys to come across here unsupervised. Okay? And that's what it was. Unsupervised, yes.
So what do you thin it with?
If it's shellac, denatured alcohol. Because shellac is alcohol, it will dissolve. I used to make my own finish. I used to get the flakes and dissolve them down in denatured alcohol. But it didn't last as long. And that product, the Zinsser seal coat, is absolutely perfect. So I don't bother making it myself. It's easier to just buy it and thin it down. Now this is a lovely thin finish. It's penetrating nicely in the wood. Can you see the figure in that? As I turn the piece of wood, can you see the grain shimmer?
Yeah.
The word for that, the French pronunciation is chatoyance. okay? We pronounce it chatoyance or chatoyancy. It derives from two French words, le chat, which is cat, and les yeux, which are eyes. So literally translated, it means cat's eyes, and cat's eyes reflect the light. And that's what this is. The light is refracting off the grain because the grain's lying at different angles. And so the word is chatoyancy. Iridescent is to do with color. Chatoyancy or chatoyance is to do with grain.
You said it was unwaxed?
Pardon?
You said it was unwaxed?
Why? Unwaxed. It's Zinser's seal coat. Really, really nice stuff. Really nice stuff. And now. Right. I've got a little bit of steel wool. And it's 4/0 steel wool. I get it from, I use Liberon. Liberon I have found to be the best. I used to use it in the UK. It's a fine, even strand without any rogue strands, and it's totally oil free. The shellac dries fairly quickly. So I'm just gonna cut this back very lightly with the 4/0 steel wool, just to level out that surface. Then I'm gonna give it a coat of oil. So I've got two levels of protection, one the sealer and one the oil. And that's just in case I inadvertently get any color on this side, or that it was thin enough there for when I switch the lathe on, when I've got to the thickness I want and I switch the lathe on after the coloring, the centrifugal force can push the color through the tube on the end grain and it can show up on this side as a little dark dot, and there's nothing you can do to get rid of it because it's in the wood, it's in the pour itself, okay? So that is what that'll do for the outside. So we'll take this off. I had it mounted on a screw chuck. The one-way screw chuck is the best screw chuck on the market, in my view. It's thick, solid, and you'd have to do something ridiculous to bend it. Absolutely ridiculous. Although I have seen them bend. Right. So, take that out of there. Right there. Turn this over. Drop the jaws back down.
Were you going to weld that?
Oh, yeah, I'll do that on the other side. I'll do it when it's in here. Right. And put your finger in the middle. And get that pressure even. Okay? That looks... There we go. You want that even across there. If you hold it like this, you might hold it at a slight angle. And when you switch it on, if it's waving, you'll end up with a thick and a thin edge. It's got to run as true as possible. So just tighten that up. You get a much better grip, a stronger grip holding into a recess than you do onto a tenon. You've got more support, okay? But the design will dictate whether you use a recess or a tenon. Tighten that to there. That's pretty good for a piece of wood. Now remember, if it is running out slightly and you know you've cut the tenon or the recess accurately, it could be that the wood's moved. This is wood, it's not metal. It's often interesting for me to watch engineers approach to wood turning. It makes me giggle. Engineers get into things like segmented work because they love to cut and measure and sand and glue up. Oh my God, I would never do that. I'd have to be in prison to do that kind of work. I'd have to have just nowhere to go. So, we're gonna take this down quickly. There's quite a lot of wood to remove. The draw cut would do it. The puff cut is even slower. This is quicker. Turn it up to 2300. Take that to there. the feed of the tool is getting slightly slower. And the reason for that is because we're getting closer to the middle, which is running slower than the peripheral speed, so the feed of the tool will get slower. You can feel what's happening when you're turning. And just to let you know, I don't normally turn like this at home. I like to enjoy the experience. I don't turn like this quickly and quite roughly. I turn quick in demos. Right, there we go. I've got the thickness that I want. Now the rim, I never, ever, ever, oh, there's some nice figure in there. Really nice figure. Not so much around there, but that's pretty. The rim, I never make the rim flat. Nobody feels it flat, okay? And I did this just recently. I've done it a few times. Up in Indiana, Mark Adams, we were doing this in the class, Platters. And I said to them, this rim wants to be a slight curve angled into the piece. That does two things. Aesthetically, with your eyes, it draws you in because the rim's curved like that. And ergonomically, you feel your way in, okay? I told him, we all did the same design, they all got nice curves on the rims, and he took it to his church meeting that night, and he counted to 12 different people, and he had to giggle every time, because when he gave them it, they did exactly what I said they'd do. He gave them it, and they went, oh, that's lovely. And their thumbs automatically did that. They won't do that if you leave it flat. If you leave it flat, it closes you out, and it doesn't draw you in ergonomically, and their fingers went like that. I don't know anybody who doesn't like the feel of a nice soft curve. Oh, sorry, sweetie. It's true. It's absolutely true, though, irrespective of what curve it is, right? Okay. So, right. So, I usually make the rim a third of the radius. Okay. So again, I make aesthetic measurements here. I just put two fingers there. I look to see if that gap's about the same. I'm not bothered if it's slightly out. A little bit out here or there. It's an aesthetic measurement. So now that's flat. Now I'm going to put the curve on. So again, I divide it roughly into thirds there. This back third, from there to there, I come this way, do a little cut here. And then for two thirds, put that soft curve in there. Do the shear cut. Now this time, the grain is running from the outside into the middle. So all your cuts should be in that direction. You shouldn't come against the grain like that. Now you have to with a scraper, and that's another thing. Any Tom, Dick, or Harry can scrape. If I got my scraper out now, and there was a guy walking along the street, and I said, hey, come here, mate, come in here. And I gave him the tool, and I said, gently push the tool on the surface of the wood. He would scrape. And he'd never picked up a tool before. Anybody can scrape. If you can learn to cut the wood, it makes the whole experience just more enjoyable, more therapeutic, and you're gonna get a nicer finish on the wood. There we go. Right. There's a very, very slight hollow. Can you see a shadow there? That means there's a slight hollow. And this surface has to be flawless and flat for colouring. Right, there's standing disc will get the rest. I'm going to try this again. So, beautiful figure, nice soft curve, and it's just a soft curve. It's not a bump, it's a subtle curve. And what I do is I feel it. When you give it to somebody else, that's what they're gonna do. So if it feels right to you, it should feel right to them, okay? I never leave square. Those two corners there, again, from an ergonomic point of view, if you give it to somebody, you will feel those two edges in your hand. If you soften it, when you give it to somebody, they won't feel the edges. How a piece feels can be just as important as how it looks. 180, 240, 320, 400. We're gonna get the alcohol-based stains. Put them in there. I will try and give this a quick sand.
Try the drill in reverse, Jimmy. It should tighten the chuck.
So it shines.
Duh.
Good man. Thank you. Very good. See, that's why you get paid the big bucks, isn't it? Eh? Yeah. As I say, your first sand is the most important one. You've got to get rid of any disturbed grain or tear out. There's one more thing I can do to help this. Right, if I put water...
That's alcohol.
I know, but if I put water on it... You've spoiled me joke now, mate. Thank you. Bloody hell. Right, so, if I spray this with water, but it's actually alcohol, it shows me what the piece is gonna finish like. Because when you put a clear liquid on a piece of wood, it darkens it one tone, right? Now, the other thing it's gonna do, it shows me what the figure's like, where the figure is. The other thing it's doing is it's raising the grain. That alcohol is soaking into the grain and it raises it, swells the grain. So, just get a lighter and just flash it off, okay? Keep the piece moving about so it doesn't burn an edge. You've got to keep it running. That dries off really quickly. And if I feel the surface now, it's like a peach skin. All the fibers stuck up, I flashed it off, burnt it, and the fibers have stayed up like that. It's easier to sand back, much, much easier, okay? I don't sand in reverse, there's no need to, if you raise the grain. And just take the obvious precautions. Don't set fire to your workshop, okay?
Denatured alcohol?
Denatured, yeah. Don't use rubbing alcohol. Keep that for rubbing, okay? It doesn't flash off quick enough. It's too oily. Yeah. .240, .320. Oh, I'll tell you what. Don't cut that on. Do not cut that little radius on the edge. You'll get it dig in with the tool and take a chunk out the rim and you'll just be fed up, okay? Flat there, flat there, just radius it in. You're sanding it on, you're putting a finish on there as well as you do it. So that was 180, we're back to the front, 320 and 400. That surface has got to be flawless. If there was any scratches in from your first sand and you don't get rid of them with subsequent sands, when you put the color on, the color will draw to that scratch and look like it'll stick out like a tram line, okay? Right, that surface is quite shiny and it will not the colour will not penetrate in very well. Just before we go any further, I'm going to put a coat of oil on the back. Is this the clubs?
No.
Right, 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 right. So, parting tool. Nice little thing there. Take that bloody thing off because it's useless, right? It's useless. It's adult proof, never mind child proof. That is much easier. Years and years, why do we have to do stuff like that? When you were kids, did your mum and dad tell you, don't drink that stuff? Did you have to put labels on and writing on like you do now? It's unbelievable, unbelievable. I'll tell you one thing, and I've said it before many times, this is the best country in the world to live in. I am more patriotic to this country than some Americans because I really appreciate what I've got over here. For anybody who's never traveled abroad and seen how other people live, you have no idea how fortunate you are to have been brought up and live in this country with what you've got. The standards are absolutely fantastic. And it's the best country in the world to live in. It's still going to hell in a handbasket, but still the best world, you know, still the best world to live in. Best part of the world, by far. Oh, it's all very interesting.
Jim, you have a question about oil. I thought that the oil worked by soaking in, and if you've already put sand and sealer on, how is the oil getting in?
Because you're not totally sealing the wood. You might seal the pores, but if you cut that back a little bit, the wood in between the pores, and remember the pores are going in at different angles, it'll still soak in a little bit. It's just, now the reason I don't oil bare wood is because, okay, if I was to put oil on this surface now, how much oil would I have to use to get this right? You've got to get it to saturation point. And it's where's it going to soak in more oil? There, in there, on the end grain. So you're feeding that and you only want the oil on or just below the surface, literally just below the surface of the wood. So if I seal that here, what I normally do is I'd seal that there, okay? Turn it around, seal this here, go back to there, seal that, and then go all the way around. So I'm sealing the end grain twice. That's blocking off the pores and giving me a much level surface to put the oil on. Have you ever tried oiling a burl, with a bare wood burl without a finish on? Where the hard bits of burr is, the hard bits, it stays shiny because the oil doesn't penetrate. But in between where the hard burr is, it goes dull. And you've got to put several coats of oil on to build it up to the same level of sheen. If you seal it first, you're not using so much oil, it takes less time to dry, and it's just a nicer, I think it's a nicer finish. Before we put the colour on, I'm just going to spray that with alcohol again and just switch the lathe on. I don't want to set fire to it. I want to open those pores up so the colour will penetrate. And that dries. You don't even have to set fire to it. It's just good fun. You know, doing stuff you're not supposed to do is even better fun. Right, so. I'll tell you what, just to make this quicker. Now, the colours that I'm... See, that's not even going to flash off. That's more or less dry now, but it's opened up those pores to take the colour. Now then, the colours that I'm using are chestnut. The brand is a chestnut stain, okay? yeah, the brand's a chestnut stain. It's one of the lads, Ken, had some today. And they come in a bottle about that big. They're alcohol-based, and there's 5% shellac mixed in with the alcohol and the colour to act as a binder. Okay, so now this stuff apparently a while back some physician told me that if you're using a lot of aniline dye, it can get through your blood system. Or obviously, if you get on your hands, it's got to go through your skin into your blood system. It works itself through your liver and could have a detrimental effect to your liver. Looking around the room, I wouldn't worry, lads. Right, so color wise I'm going to do two blues, yellow and green. Okay, what do you want? Do you want the sunset-y colors, which are reds, purples, oranges and that type of thing, like a sunset, or do you want greeny blues like Google Earth?
Sunset
colors. Right, okay then. So one there. Okay, I'm going to start with black and then red and blue together, which will give me what? Well, if you mix red and blue, what will you get?
Purple.
And then red and yellow, okay? The black, red and yellow make orange. The black is going to give me a nice background, a nice dark background. Okay, and then the yellow and the sunsets are going to be in between. When I apply this black, I will see straight away where the figure is in the wood, okay? And put a nice sweep on there. Don't put on little tiny bits, get a nice even nice even sweep around there and get a good tone, good dark tone of black. I'm going to sand this back afterwards. I've left the guts in the middle, and the reason I've left the guts in the middle is because if I'd taken the guts out, the wood would move, and when I'm sanding this back, I'm going to get an uneven finish on the surface of the wood. When you take the middle out of anything, that there, that wood there in the middle is holding everything together. And if you get rid of it, the wood's going to move. There's nothing you can do to stop it. So give that a nice, even coat up to there. Now, when I look at this, it's better there. You see, there's a dark line there, a dark line there, a dark line there. And then in between the dark lines, there's light lines. Where the dark line is, the grain is sticking up like that. And when you put the colour on, it penetrates into the wood. It doesn't matter how much you sand that back, you're going to be left with that dark tone in the grain. These lighter areas here, there, 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 the grain's lying more flat. The colour can't get down the ends of the tubes and has to run around the sides. And therefore, the tubes aren't filled. When you sand back that back, you're opening up tubes that have no colour in, and they become the lighter areas, and that's where you put the next colour. Though this type of wood tells you how to do it. And it's very difficult to colour wood that isn't figured. Very, very, very difficult, because you've got to make the colours work. I can't improve on nature. That's a gorgeous piece of wood. But what I'm trying to do is emphasise what is already there using the aesthetic medium of colour. So, 400, I'm going back down to a 320, because I want to sand that black back quicker. Don't use pads, these discs. It's an expensive way to do this. Use sheet paper, because there's shellac on there, and the shellac will clog up the paper, okay? And you have to throw it away. Okay, I'm gonna sand less here and more there, and have the colors fade out from lighter to darker surrounding where I'm gonna hollow it. That'll emphasize the hollowing just a little bit more. Going the right way. Going back down to 240. It's not removing it quicker, and that's too fast as well. Turn it down to a very sedate 1200. Now, depending on how much I sand this back at this stage, will dictate how light or dark the whole piece is at the end. That was a 240. I need a fresh 240. And a 400 because it's a 320 because it's just not cutting back quick enough. The other thing you can do, remember as well what the solvent is for this. There's nothing stopping you taking colour off by getting a bit of kitchen roll and taking it around there. That's dissolving it a little bit in that area. And that's going to make it easier to sand back, and it's getting rid of the shellac on the surface. That should colour much easier now.
You want to continue to remove this colour while it's
I want to remove as much of the black as I need to, yep. So I can see the next colour in between.
Do you want to do it while it's wet?
The black.
Do what while it's wet?
Removing that colour, because that colour is still wet, isn't it?
No, it's dried now. It's alcohol-based, and I just set fire to it, so it's dry. Oh, okay. And that's why I like the alcohol stains, because you can set fire to them. If you use water-based stains, you have to wait till each colour is dry to see the true colour. And if you keep putting water on there, the wood can start to move as well. So, yeah, it's got to be dry when you do it, yeah. That's better. I'll stop that. There, I'm starting to see a bit more definition now. I've still got the dark. I need to sand just a little bit more in there. Then I'm going to put the next colour on. That should be fine. Okay, excellent. So, red and then blue. That's going to give me a purple, then red, and then orange going into yellows, okay? So I'll give this a wash of the red, and by a wash, I mean a wash over the surface. This is very similar to watercolor painting. You can take it off and you can put it back on, and really, you can't really get this wrong. It looks good or it doesn't look good, but you can't really get it wrong, okay? So, we'll put the red on. I'm going to sweep it over the whole surface, because eventually, oh, that's going to work nicely. That's going to work nicely. So that's the red. A blue on top of that is going to give me a purple. Then I'll sand back a little bit more here, not in there, sand a little bit more there and into here. Then I'll flash red into there, then yellow. And when the yellow hits the red, it'll give me orange, and I'll have yellow tips out at this outside edge, okay? So I'm trying to use colors that work with each other. If you go to Dick Blick's or somewhere where buy a color wheel, you'll see which colors work with each other. And it's worth buying. They're only a couple of dollars, and they're really worth buying. So if I put the blue over the top of that, that's giving me a purple down in this area. I've still got the darker lines of the black there. That needs just a little bit more. I'm actually now working with the figure, not the grain. It's the figure that I'm working with, because that's what I want to emphasize. So I'm just rubbing that blue into here. I don't want that dark band around there. And the other thing you've got to do, as I said, is make sure there's no little hollows in this. Because when you put the color on and sand back, if there's a slight little hollow, you'll have a light area there, a light area there, and a dark area where the hollow is. You'll have a dark ring, okay? So, that's the purple. I'm gonna go back to this red, flick a little bit of red in, then sand it back a bit, then add some yellow. So, I'm just gonna flick that into here. Again, going with the grain. With the figure, which is that way. Flick this out. And I'm not doing hard wipes like that. I'm kind of flicking it on. If you do a hard wipe, you get an edge, which is difficult to blend in. I'm going to spray this with alcohol and get everything to blend in nicely at the end. So that needs, 320 now, again. I want to lighten that area up. So I see the yellow and the orange a bit more. Right, now yellow. And you won't really see this until the whole surface is finished. And that's perfect for the finish. Perfect, the clear gloss lacquer. Okay, to put the last finish on. So a little bit of, bit more paper, and I'm just going to flick yellow into these lighter areas, because that's where you're going to see that yellow more, where it's lighter. Sorry mate, am I keeping you awake? Have you? Sorry about that. You didn't have to come tonight, you know. Right, so I'm just getting the corner here on the paper, and I've folded it over so I've got a straight line, a straight edge. I'm just going to flick yellow into that area there, these areas here, just to highlight it a little bit. Now there's not much figure there, so I'm not going to put any colour, because there's not much to emphasise. Get that through there, come from the top, it's easier, there we go. Because I want to follow that grain. So follow the figure in the wood. Take that through to there. That's coming through here. And it's a stipple, like a soft dabbing on the surface. Right, I need a bit more red. That's not red enough in this section. So a little bit more red. Then what I'll do is I'll spray it up and then take the middle out, then finish the rim at the very end, okay? It'll be quicker doing that way than waiting for a few minutes for the lacquer to dry. So again, a little bit more red on the corner. Just flick it into there. It's obviously coming through here. There. And a bit into this section here. So, when I spray this, the colour you see when I spray it with the alcohol is the colour that I'm going to end up with when I put the final finish on, because I'm darkening it one tone. And I'm just, now when you spray it with alcohol, you want a fine mist. Don't have a jet on there, and you want a fine mist, but what you have to do is put enough alcohol on there to get the colours to blend in, but don't put too much alcohol, so we get what is called a curtain of alcohol flowing across the surface, and it drags the colours with it, and you end up with a dark tide line when it dries. Okay, so just hit that. Just get all those colours to blend in nicely. Now, if you felt after you'd sprayed it and the colours were a little bit more muted, there's nothing stopping you going back, because when you wet the surface, the colours run into each other, and you might lose a little bit of the definition of one of them, and it's normally the yellow, which is the lightest one. So there's nothing stopping you after you've sprayed it, just to put a hint of yellow, if you need to, back onto that surface. And then if you need to, you can respray it again. If you didn't like the whole lot, you can turn it off and start again. In fact, I'll tell you what I would have done, had we had time and we were doing this in a class or whatever, I would have left it that thick, cleaned it off, turned a rim, sanded it, finished it, and had a go at colouring. Turned that off, done another one. So leave your piece of wood thick, and you've got three or four attempts at colouring before you get to the final colour sequence that you want. And it'll look even more pronounced when we take the middle out. So, that's that. Tool rest, up to here. Right, have you ever had the situation where, let me get rid of this, 24. Right, have you ever had the situation where you try to pick the cut up and the tool scoots back at you? The reason for that is because you will not be getting the bevel in control first. What you should do, get the bevel rubbing, that will not cut till I push the handle away from me. There we go. I've got a tiny little flat and a little bit of that bevel on that flat. So I've got the control of the tool. I can open the flute to about 45. And push it through. So again, you start there, pick the cut up, get that bevel rubbing, open the flute to 45, then push it through. You've got all the control you need, and that flute has to be at about 130 or 1030 for 45 degrees. 12, 3, 130 is 45, okay? And if that's at 45, it's cutting efficiently. Watch, if I close the flute down, and that's what some of the guys do, because they've had an almighty catch, they think, oh, bugger that, I'm gonna turn it right down. All you're doing is that wing is scraping on a flat surface. You're scraping. Look at those cuts, it's a scrapey cut. And I'm having to force that to make it cut. If I just open the flute, watch, to 45, and a little bit of pressure, it's feeding itself through perfectly. Close it down, scraping, open it up, cutting, okay? And the reason it scoots back at you is because, if I turn this right down to there, I'm gonna hold the tool here, so I'm not influencing it. What the guards are doing is they're putting the tip of the tool on with no bevel, so they're going straight onto the tip of the tool, onto the point, without any bevel, and the flute will be slightly open. And watch, scoots back, but only it does that a lot quicker when it's running quicker. Okay, so they would put there, scoots back. I'm not influencing, and that's what it is. You haven't got the bevel in control. The bevel is not only controls the tool, but it tells you in which direction you cut. So what you could do, let's get this faster. go in with a parting tool. That gives you a little shoulder to rest the bevel on. Then you can cut away from that. The tool can't come back that way and then across. It's impossible. Does that make sense, what I've just said? Right. See how I'm stepping them cuts? I'm making, if the lads catch with this tool, they catch this wing there, somewhere there. I'm watching the tip of the tool and I'm stopping the cut there. I'm stopping short of each one so I can't catch that wing. The other thing is I'm leaving the guts in the middle. Most people, when they turn a bowl, hollow from the middle first. That's, to me, technically, now everybody does it. Everybody does it. And it's not so relevant on smaller bowls because you're through them before they start to move. But on the bowls you're turning, that big, that deep, if you start turning from the middle first, you're releasing all the tension and stress that's holding everything together, and the wood moves. And you're trying to pick a cut up out here, and the tool's, you can't pick the cut up. It seems logical to me, logical, to get this bit right first, if it was one of your bowls, and get it right in stages as you're going down, leaving the guts in the middle until you don't need them anymore. That's a common sense thing to me. Everybody still hollows from the middle. It just seems right to get in stages, then I never have to go back to it. And quite often, the lads have turned a bowl and there's something not quite right at the first inch of the rim of the bowl, and it's maybe that deep. And the tendency is to get this winged tool and just try and scrape that out. The wood has already moved, it'll be flexing, you'll hear a chatter noise, and because it's not picking the cut up, the lads push harder and the piece of wood flexes into the wing, and at best you'll be left with a wide groove, a wide torn groove around the edge of the bowl. At worst it'll explode, okay? So that, keep an eye on your wings. I want to try and undercut this slightly, and the only tool that's going to do that for me is this little micro bevel. So, tools. Put that into there. So this is a micro bevel. It was sharpened at 45 degrees. I've ground the heel away and then put a much shorter bevel on. That's going to get me around this tighter curve. I just have to give myself a little bit of room and get rid of that. The easiest way to get rid of this, the push cut, if you're practicing your cuts, use this to practice, okay? That's tediously slow, okay, for a push cut. This is a little quicker. But this is quicker still, and I'm cutting downhill. It's waste wood that I'm turning away. The only cut that really matters is your last cut, the finishing one. Now that I've given myself a little bit of room, I can use this micro bevel. And that's given me a beautiful clean cut, even on the end grain. I can feel it, okay? I can tell by looking at the cut. There's a little bit of a ribble at the edge. If I stop that, there's absolutely no tear out whatsoever. That's clean, nicely cleanly cut. I'm checking my thickness there. Now I'm going to start to take the curve through to the middle. I don't need that tool anymore because I've finished with it. This tool, that tool will get the rest of that. So that tool was just to get around that tight curve. Go back to this, because I put a line in there when I made that cut. Now we can just finish taking the rest. That bit there, the bit in the middle, never do this. If you do that, A, you've got far too much pressure on, B, You're going to tear the wood from underneath. That's badly torn. Your cut in the middle should finish like this. You should never, if you break out the other side, you've got too much pressure on. Remember, it's hardly running at all in the middle, so the feed of the tool should be slower. Pick that up to there. Ah, there's a, I'm just going to see, there's something there making the tool kick. Ah, it's a bit of grain. Right, so, come back here. There. Right. What time is it, please?
8:30.
Right. So, right, what I'm going to do is lacquer the rim. I need a little bit of steel wool just to cut back because the alcohol will still raise the grain very, very slightly. Some people say, no, alcohol doesn't raise the grain. It does. It's a liquid, and if the fibres will soak in that liquid, it doesn't matter what it is, it'll raise the grain. So a little bit of this, just to level off that surface. Right, now this piece can always be remounted, okay? It's got the recess in. What I want to do, and this is for time-wise, unless you tell me different, I'm here for you, not for me, okay? If you want me to sand and finish the inside and then lacquer it up, I can do that. Or I can lacquer it up now, show you what it looks like, and then get on to the next project. And one of you guys can remount this. It won't take long to finish that, okay? There's one or two little high spots. They'll stand out in no time. Do you want me to do that so I can get on the other project?
Yeah. Yeah.
Good. Good. Right, so put that there. Right, I'm going to lacquer it up. Now, the finish that I put on this, I use car finishes. I use Meguiar's rubbing compound, then Meguiar's polishing compound, then hard shell turtle wax. I'm finishing the finish. That's what I'm doing. Okay? And it gives you an amazing... It looks like, well, the piece looks like it's been dipped in glass. You get a flawless finish, and that traps the light and reflects it back, and it makes that rim look deep, really, really deep. So, give that a good shake. Never spray with a cold tin, okay? Because if you do, on a cold day, if you come out and do this, and you pick up a cold tin, you get what I call spitty bits coming out, okay? Warm the tin up, put it in the sun for a while. Warm the tin up and that increases the pressure and you get a more even spray, okay? And different qualities. Minwax is quite a good one. That's got a good nozzle. Some of the cheaper sprays have a crappier nozzle on there and you don't get a nice even spray, okay? So when you're spraying, it's very light. You don't want to put an orange peel effect on there because it's much harder to sand back. I love the smell of this stuff, it's really good. Oh, sorry, I know. It is a nice smell. I like the smell of the shellac as well. Right, so, now then, one other thing. At the moment, we have colour going on that side, on the edge, and there's nothing to tie it in. So what works really well is if you get a black Sharpie, and those colours are wandering out, but there's nothing to tie it in. And you might have got some colour on this side. Just get a black Sharpie, okay, and just colour it in. Move the wood by hand. Don't switch the lathe on. You'll destroy the tip of the pen, and it won't deposit the ink. So to the outside edge first. Now, the other thing what this does is I don't want to put a black line on this surface because your eye would be drawn straight to that. It wouldn't complement. It would just boo, be there. Because this is a slight radius when I put the black on, when you look at this from this side, you still see the faintest of black lines around this edge because it's part of the radius and that just frames it nicely. It's a design nuance, but it works really, really well. pen's getting a bit. That one looks newer. That's a bit better. So you would colour this in black, okay? And that frames the colours really, really well. Now if I just get rid of that. Chucky. Hold it gently there. Now if you get that right, when it's really shiny and you get it in the light, it looks absolutely stunning. It looks better in daylight than it does in natural light. And you're just trying to emphasize what is already there using the aesthetic medium of color. But you need a figured piece of wood to do it. It makes
a... the McGuire's and the car wax after the last...
I give it several, because I've been using Deft. And I'll give that about 10 coats, okay?
Of lacquer.
Then what I do is I get 800 grit wet and dry. I have a little container of water here, and I dip the wet and dry in the water, and I cut this back until it's flat. By flat, I mean not shiny. And then you use the different compounds, and it just pops. Like, it just looks unbelievable. Unbelievable. So that gentleman needs a bit more building up of the... I'll put this to one side, and then when it's dry, I'll remount it and give it a coat of oil so you can see what it looked like, really shiny. That doesn't even do it justice at the moment. If I put a bit of oil on, it'll look better. Has anybody got any questions about what I've just done? Have I explained it well enough, or are you just happy to watch some limey talk funny and turn shavings? Eh?